may take a while. See this girl, she sort of looks just like you. She even smiles just the way you do. So innocent, she seemed, but I was cool. I'm reminded when I look at you, but you remind me.
Good morning.
Come on in.
Good morning. It is Friday. Good morning, Angel. I don't speak about politics on social media. Sorry, Michael. Good morning. We're going to get ready to get into everything in a second. Welcome. I am Keith K.L. Belvin, crisis specialist, human service counselor, and every Friday from 11:30 to 1 o'clock. We discuss different things that have to deal with personal transformation, relationship issues, and things along that nature. I am a crisis specialist and a human service counselor. Hey, Foxy. And what I try to do is bring things to the table that can help people deal with the issues that they may be dealing with in their current lives. So that's what we talk about, Michael, every week. And this week we're talking about 10 ways to identify red flags when dating. Because I'm a professional counselor. I am also an educator and an educational consultant. I'm an author. And what I do in terms of trying to help other people is to bring up situations that I know people deal with. Good luck. That's a really tough subject. Well, listen, we gotta find a way to be able to have the conversation. So what I do is just from my professional opinion, my personal experiences, try to bring things to the table. Good morning to the table that might enlighten, entertain, inform, and educate. If I can do that, then I did my job for the day. And if anybody, this is your first time here, one, thank you for joining. And if this is your first time, please let me know where you're checking in from so I can offer you a direct good morning. I always like to know where people are checking in from. And to the folks that are regularly here on Friday from 11:30 to 1 o'clock, great to have you here. Appreciate you. We'll get into the little housekeeping stuff in a minute. Shout out from Louisiana. Shout out from the A. Appreciate you. And again, if you didn't hear what I was explaining to Brother Mike when he asked, what I am a crisis specialist. Hey, there's the shout out to the moderator, super moderator Ellie, who's here. I don't think Ellie's going to be with us all day, guys. So we're going to rock out while we got Ellie here with us. But yes, I'm a crisis specialist, human service counselor. So I provide professional private counseling to those that need it. I do couple counseling. I even work with some children, not as many. Hey, shout out from GA. Not as many children as I used to. I do own and run an after-school program. I don't talk about politics, and no, I'm not talking about the crisis at the border. Sorry. It's not what I do here. We talk about the things that people deal with directly in terms of their personal situations as well as relationships and stuff like that. The situation at the border, the reason why I don't have that conversation, because the problem is, if we're not going to talk about the things that led up to the crisis and what's going on in this country, the crisis at the border is just one part of everything else that's going on. So I leave it alone. Because you have moral issues, political issues, as well as human rights issues. And folks don't want to have multiple level conversations. They want to have conversations from their political views, and that's why I don't have political views conversations online. Serves no purpose for me, and I'm an independent. I don't care about the right or the left. I care about how people are treated, so. And that's what we do. We can pray. I'm all for praying. I am a crisis counselor at that as well. I work with churches to build mental health ministries because we have to find a way to help people emotionally, and that's what I do. And the church, I believe, is dropping the ball because we need to be able to help the people who come into the church really deal with their problems. So I work with a church here in Delaware where I'm located. I work with a church in Maryland, and I work with a church in Alabama. I want to talk to you. I lost my son. He was 16. Okay, then reach out to me privately, and maybe I can help, or you can ask your question now. Matthew 6 says to pray in private. Why do no Christians listen to that? Well, a lot of people don't pay attention to what they read or put into motion what they read. And again, if you're new, by all means, say hello. Tell me where you're checking in from. Let me turn this off. I'll get back to the music in a second. Okay, so it's after 11:30, and I see a lot of the regulars checking in. And thank you for the compliment. Appreciate it. I try to do what I do. So again, I will again introduce myself. I am Keith K.L. Belvin, Crisis Specialist, Human Service Counselor. Every Friday from 11:30 to 1 o'clock, 1:30, depending on how the conversation. I'm going to go back to the music. I got you. Appreciate you. Every Friday from 11:30 to 1 o'clock, sometimes 1:30, depending on how the conversation is going, I am on to discuss various different subjects. Often I'll take subjects from you guys in the chat and put something together. So this week, Perfectly Imperfect, who is a regular here, she asked about identifying. She said, could I talk about red flags? So this week, we are talking about 10 ways to identify red flags when dating. That's what we're talking about this week. I am the author of 7 books and working on 2 others. Thank you, Ellie. All my previous shows over on YouTube if you want to go check them out. I have a new book coming out next month, 12 Steps to Recovering from a Toxic Relationship. Good Morning from Ohio. That is dropping next month. And again, it's a guide to help you figure out what to do once you have gotten out of a toxic relationship. Because often we free ourselves from the negative relationship, but then we don't know what to do. So great to see you. First time here. Appreciate you. So what I did was created a book based on somebody from here on TikTok actually asked me, hey, shout out from the D. I was in Detroit 2016, spoke at Wayne State University. Yes, the information of everything is in my bio. If you look in my bio, all of my information is in my bio. So if you're interested in private counseling, if you're interested in any of my books, all my information, website, everything about me is in my bio. I don't hide anything, and this is my actual real name. There's no reason for me to hide. This is my government name. I don't play these games. I am Keith K.L. Belvin. So with that said, the only housekeeping rules I have, one, we must be respectful to everybody here in the chat. Super moderator Ellie, if she sees something that's negative, if she catches it before I do, you will get blocked. I would rather not have you blocked because this is a safe space. And what I mean, hey, shout out, great to have you here, Navajo. And what I mean by safe space is you are respected unless you choose to be disrespectful. Well, then we don't entertain disrespect. You got to go. Again, if you have a question, by all means, as I'm giving the list, if you have a question, put it out there. I'll answer. My only requirements is you see over here. You see the hearts going up? I have ADD. I know this is going to sound crazy. I have ADD, but for whatever reason, those hearts going up on the side allow me to focus. It also sends word over to other folks on the app that we're over here, and that brings them over because TikTok will use the algorithm and move me other places to other people's For You page. So it also lets me know that you're enjoying the content. So right there, I want to see the hearts going up as we're talking and as I'm offering what I'm offering. Now, a moment of transparency. And again, if you're new, make sure that you come into the room and let us know what part of the country or world, because I do have some folks who have joined us from other parts of the world, where you're joining us from. Now, what am I selling? I'm not selling anything, but what happened to good morning, Lucho? What happened to good morning? What I'm selling is information. What I'm selling is entertainment. What I'm selling is engagement, if you want to consider that selling. But again, what happened to good morning? Shout out from Indianapolis. Shout out from Indianapolis. Now, I got to be transparent, right? Today was one of those days that I was not going to come on. Shout out from Bofa. I was just sitting here and I just was like, you know what? I'm really not in the mood to interact today. And then I thought about something. I spoke to someone this week and I had a wonderful conversation and I met her right here in the chat. She needed some help. And I thought about something that she shared with me and also something I thought about when I was in the classroom. When I showed up for teaching, I taught for 20 24 years in New York City school system. The kids that came to school, it wasn't their concern if I was having a bad day. Many of them expected me to be who I was supposed to be. So when I came in the morning, I couldn't bring my problems into the building and then put that on the kids that was expecting me to do what I do. In a counseling session, if I'm having a bad day and I still take the counseling session, I can't bring my garbage or my baggage to the table for somebody who's expecting help from me. So I caught myself and said, nope. If Ellie, super moderator Ellie, can let me know, and she does this volunteer work, first of all, that she's going to be here and she may not be able to stay, and she shows up, no pay, no nothing, just because she enjoys being here, then I can show up. And I just wanted to be transparent about that, because I try to stay upbeat all the time, but sometimes even a strong man gets tired. So that's my moment of transparency. So with that said, first and foremost, thank you so much. I appreciate you. Is that ABN? And if I got that wrong, I apologize. All right, before we go any further, let's give a warm shout out to my super moderator, Ellie. Let's put those purple hearts up. Purple hearts is the way we express our affection for others in the group. Let's put those purple hearts up for Ellie, because I could not do what I do without Ellie, man in the chat, because like I said, I have ADD. I'd be caught all up in the chat with trying to respond. But let's give some purple hearts to Ellie as a way to say thank you, because she volunteers to be here, and I'm going to give her flowers and everything else. Where do we find purple hearts? You just have to go to wherever your emojis are on your phone, and when you go to put in instead of letters, you're going to put in purple hearts. Okay, thank you, thank you. I see the purple hearts. Oh, let me get back to the music, hold on too. So, and I also want to say, anytime that we have a list, and this time we have 10, once we get to the halfway point, we will have a little music break. That's where we just hang out, listen to some of the music. All right, so you guys, tell me how you're doing since last Friday. How has your week been since I spoke to you last? And if this is your first time here, well then tell me how you're doing so far. Put it in the chat. Let's hear how everybody's doing. Let me hear from you guys. How are you guys doing this week? Well, thank you. I appreciate that. May God bless you as well. Bless all of us. We need it right now in these troubling times. I thank you. Hey, Roberta. Okay. Roberta said okay. I got my wisdom teeth. Ooh, Lord. Okay. Well, I'm glad you ain't got no pain. And keep taking that Tylenol. Unless they gave you the better stuff. But be careful with the better stuff. Love the live on Chill Time. Okay. Appreciate you. Yeah, I was a former basketball coach, international basketball coach, and I coach young adults and young guys, young ladies. And so, basketball is just, that's my private passion. Hanging in there, no love relationship. Hanging there, love, no relationship status. Okay, got you. Hey, big dog, just getting by day to day. Yeah. Hey, Sadie. Yeah, thank you. And if y'all don't know, yes, that is my nickname, Big Dog. I don't know why. Appreciate it. Yeah, I got to be transparent. Cancer survivor, let's go. Hey, let's give Lady Perkins some purple hearts for being a cancer survivor. Let's go. Because F cancer. Let's give Lady Perkins some purple hearts as a cancer survivor. Way to go. That's what I'm talking about. Shout out to Lady Perkins. Been a challenging with my new home issue with the warranty company. And I know those struggles. Document everything, even your phone calls, text messages, everything. Try to do more. Either by text message or email, so you have some type of digital proof, because warranty companies are not trying to lay out no dough. I'm learning how to stop attaching myself to toxic situations, relationships, and praying more. Well, you're going to need my book that's coming out on how to recover from those relationships. My book drops next month, but just focus on you. If you're having troubles with certain things, focus on your choices by focusing on the things that you think you want, think you need, because that can change. So if we're attracting the same type of people or the same type of situations, we have to change the things that we're doing, and then we can change the attractions to certain people. Thank you. That's exactly what I'm trying to do. Okay. How can I order? Book drops next month, but you can always go to my bio. The link for the book is the pre-order is in my book. My son is an Army veteran. He wrote a book on PTSD. Shout out to your was that you said son or brother? Let me make sure I got that right. Your son. Hey, shout out to your son. And as a 7-time author, and I've been a contributor to a bunch of anthologies, it is not an easy thing to write a book. So anytime I come across a fellow author, respect. All right. And tell them to keep promoting. Only way people are going to know the book is out there, he has to let them know why he wrote it, who he wrote it for, and what his experiences are inside the book. As you see, I talk about my book on a regular because this is what I do. And next month, when the book drops again, I'm still going to be talking about toxic relationships because the goal is to create a guide to be able to help people figure out what are you going to do once you get out of this negative situation. And today we're talking 10 ways to identify red flags when dating. All right, now y'all sloughing off on the hearts over there, see? Now I got to tell you, tap the screen, this is what we doing? Right here, what's going on over here with these hearts, see? Y'all messing up already. All the new folks, if you see me pointing over here like this, it means that you are not tapping the screen. I want to learn how to get rid of soul ties. You put them in the rearview mirror and you focus on your future. 37 years I lived this life as a whore. I was just out here living my life foul. The last 18 years, my focus has been on the Lord, my wife, and doing what is right. So the soul ties that I connected, I put behind me because I do not interact with them. I do not give in to them. Any temptation that I feel, I focus on forward. I focus on my faith. I focus on my wife. I focus on the work that I'm doing now. The distance between you and the soul ties was necessary for you to be able to take ownership or take back your ownership of your body and your mind, your spirit, and everything. Won't the Lord do what you need? No, the Lord will do what he needs to do for us. And I am a humble host of what the Lord wants. He doesn't do what we need. He'll give us what we need. And I know what you were trying to say. I'm big on words because I think sometimes we minimize God and realize that, man, listen, I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for him. All things work together for God. Yes, they do. And I am proof of that because based on what I've done, I shouldn't be here. But the Lord had different plans, and I don't take that lightly. I also don't take waking up in the morning lightly. I told my daughter that this morning. She woke up and said, I really don't like school. Stop that. You got up this morning. And when my students used to ask me, how come I come in all bubbly every morning? And I always tell them what my great-grandmother told me. Boy, you better smile when you wake up because somebody didn't wake up this morning. You better appreciate that. And I've always remembered that. So I get up. I'm excited. I'm excited because somebody is on the other side and they don't have no answers of what they're going to explain when they get to that front of the line. All right, y'all keep tapping that screen. We're going to get ready to get started. Does a relationship or situation work when a person does not have the same relationship with God? It can, but you have to have a very strong understanding of each other, a very strong respect for each other. So just because you're a person of faith and the other person isn't, doesn't mean it can't work. Now you got to understand that you have to accept what your difficulties are going to be. And again, it's about communication, respect, and boundaries. And if you have those things in place, your relationship can work. But you got to know going in what the difficulties will be, and you have to be prepared to be able to deal with them, because you can't force somebody to understand what your faith is, and you're not going to stop being of your faith. But you guys can have a working union, but you really want to be able to communicate where you two are with that, the boundaries there, and how you're going to go there. Been married 21 years, first marriage was 25 years. Okay, congratulations. I am happily divorced and happily remarried. Unequally yoked. Not, yes, they are, but how long does it take people to become equally yoked? Navajo, and that's what I'm getting at. Just because they're dating now does not mean that they cannot become equally yoked. Remember, everything requires a genesis. So we have to be careful when we tell somebody they're unequally yoked, because at the moment, yes, but if they're working on it, they can actually become it. Remember, many of us came to the Lord not understanding that we needed him, and then because of exposure to him, we actually gave ourselves over to him. So everything requires time. That's the only reason why I didn't bring up unequally yoked. The person has to get there. And we have to be able to give that person time to get there. Unfortunately, a lot of our churches don't give people time and automatically rough them off because they didn't come away and toss away everything. But because I am a follower of Jesus, not a follower of the church, I understand that people need time, people need communication, people need understanding, and people need great teaching. Teach it the right way, show it the right way, people will figure it out. What does it mean when you keep meeting people with trauma, but you healed yours? Well, if you keep meeting with trauma, the first question, or not just trauma, when you keep meeting people of a certain ilk, two things. One, there might be external forces leading you to them, or you got to check your choices. So I would take a step back and look at where I'm meeting these people, two, how I'm meeting these people, and is there a benefit to what I'm actually meeting them for, or is it a problem? So there's a lot that would go into that question, but that's what I would give on the fly. What does it mean when you have ideations? Well, the idea of when you're having thoughts about anything, the question becomes, where are they triggered? Where are they coming from? And when you have certain ideations, you have certain thoughts, you have to figure out what is triggering those thoughts, where those thoughts are coming from, and what they're connected to. All right, so let's get ready to get started. If you guys are ready to get started, we're going to talk about 10 ways to identify red flags when dating. This is the focus of today. There are not too many people who don't have some... Everybody has some type of trauma. Everybody has some form of trauma. The question becomes, what role does the trauma play in their life and how does the trauma affect them? And when we say trauma, we have to be careful because we attach such a big word to sometimes minor things. We all have difficulties, yes. Trauma is something different, but we all suffer from different things. The question becomes, how do we react to it? How do we accept it? And then, of course, how do we deal with it going forward? All right, so if you guys are ready to get started today, I want you to put yes in the chat if you're ready to get started. If you got your notebook, you got your pens. We're going to get into 10 ways to identifying red flags when dating. All right, so if you guys are ready, put yes in the chat. Let me get 10 yeses, and we're going to get ready to get started. Here we go. There go the yeses. Appreciate you. Let's go. And remember, keep tapping that screen. We're going to make this happen today. Let's go. All right. So let me put my little sheet up here. I got to put it where I can see it. Okay. Number one, 10 ways to identify red flags when dating. Here we go. Turn that down just a little bit. I don't want to get sidetracked with the music. Excuse me, guys. I'm sorry. Sometimes when the music's on, believe it or not, I actually get to sing it in my head. Hello, Mystique. Mystic, I'm sorry. Hello. Great to have you here. Okay. Number one on the list of 10 ways to identify red flags when dating. And this was given to us last week by Perfectly Imperfect. Number one is to pay attention to their behavior. Okay. Number one, pay attention to their behavior. Paying attention to someone's behavior is a crucial way to identify red flags when dating. All right? It is super important. You got to watch how they move. Often we'll see things that tip us off that something's wrong, and we ignore it. If you've done that, put me in the chat. If you have seen things at the very beginning that are negative and ignored it, put a me in the chat. And since I'm not typing the chat, I'll put my hand up. Put a me in the chat if you have seen some things at the very beginning and you literally ignored it. There you go. And I'll ask those questions because I want us to all see that we have things in common. These are some of the things that we talk about in the counseling session. The why. Why did we ignore it? Sometimes we ignore it because we are doubting or we're scared. Well, there's many different reasons of why we ignore it. But what I want you to understand is that we are all connected, that many of us have done that, that we have just ignored things that we know. But by paying attention, that will tip you off. Trust your eyes. Because if it is a behavior, right, it will show itself more than once. Trust your eyes. Trust what you see. When somebody shows you, trust it. Okay, now you don't always have to say anything. What's going on over here? Really? Y'all playing today, right? We gonna get this started early. Y'all gonna stop playing with these hearts today. Who just put that little one heart up? Y'all gonna tap that screen. Let's go. Why y'all do me like this every day? You know, it's because I turned the music down. That's what it is. Come on. All right, so we got that. So paying attention to behavior. And I can tell you is that when you see it, please make note, because when you see it the second time, there's your confirmation. There's your song. Okay, sing with me. And hey, you guys at work, don't just start singing and your boss come over and you get in trouble because you're watching me. We are focused. I love it. I love it. Who's that, Jai? Is it Jay or Jai? And again, I want to make sure I get right. I have a thing with names. What type of behavior should we pay attention to? That's a hard question, Mystic, because I don't know the person that you're with. Also, I don't know what's okay or not okay for you. Now, there's some behaviors like disrespect, rudeness. Those are the basics. You know that. How somebody speaks to somebody, how somebody moves around other people. When you feel it's in your body, you found something. When you see the song, so I'm reading it. So to your question, Mystic, things that you are uncomfortable with, because what you may be comfortable with, I may not be. What I may be comfortable with, you may not be. So what you want to do is you want to be able... Oh, Jessica, got you. Okay, Jess. What you want to do is you want to pay attention to things that don't sit right with you. What I pay attention to is how somebody treats other people. I know they're going to put on the face for me. I know that they're going to act a certain way around me. I watch how they treat other people. I watch how they treat their family. I watch how they talk to strangers. I watch how they talk to homeless people. I watch how they talk to executives. I watch how people interact with other people. Because with me, I know I'm going to meet someone's representative. And I watch that type of behavior. If their change is short, do they wild out? I look for things that is going to tip me off to go, okay, there might be more there than I need to deal with. I need to check that out, okay? So that's number one. And when I point over here, y'all already know what's going on. Stop playing and stop tapping. Keep tapping that screen. Okay, ready for number two. Let me get 10 twos in the chat. Let's go on to number two. All right? Put a two in the chat if you're ready to move on to number two. And again, if this is your first time here, I am Keith K.L. Belvin, crisis specialist, human service counselor, author. And every Friday we're here from 11:30 to 1 o'clock, 1:30, whatever time. And the goal is to entertain, educate, and to inform. So this is what I do. And welcome. If it's your first time here, thank you. I appreciate you. You could be anywhere in the world, but you're here with me. So number two, and I just said what it is for me, but I'll give it to you. Number two is observe how they treat others, which I just said, that's a big one for me. Number two is observe how they treat others. Observing how someone treats others, such as wait staff or their friends, can give you insight into their character. Okay? And that's a big one for me. See, I know that people are going to act a certain way around me. I've been in high-level situations. I've been in low-level situations. I don't feel I'm above anybody. Yes, I'm a professional counselor. Yes, I went to school. Yes, I have a bunch of degrees. And I'll still feel as comfortable out in the hood with my family and friends as anybody else. I code switch with the best of them. What I cannot deal with, which bothers me, is when people treat other people badly for no reason. That tells me you have a character flaw. And I really don't want to be in the presence of people like that. I also cannot be, or I try not to be, around people who look down on others for very minuscule reasons. I don't like it to begin with, but when you find something silly or stupid to look down at somebody, I know you have an issue with yourself. I'm not the dude you really want to hang out with. And a lot of times I'll quietly excuse myself. I don't make a scene. That's not the place for me to try to hold a counseling session. Stop trying to correct people who don't rock what you rock with. Just leave. A crowd is not the place. Social media is not the place for you to try to correct someone else. I see a lot of that on this app and other apps. People want to come into a loaded environment and they want to try to correct a person in their space. You can't do that. They won't hear you. You cannot try to correct somebody on their page with a bunch of people digging them, and you are now just getting shouted at and everything else, so nothing that you say is going to be heard. Don't do that. Just ease off, step off. If the person hits up and go, hey, why'd you leave? Now you can have that conversation. Hey, you just left the party. Now you can say, yes, I left because I watched the way you treated so-and-so. I watched the way you treated the waiter. I saw the way you treated the bus driver, the Uber driver. Step away. Same thing on social media. Don't get caught up in coming into somebody's box. And like me, I don't go into boxes where there's drama. I don't go live that often unless I have something to bring to the table, to the conversation. And once the conversation gets to yelling and screaming, I excuse myself, politely, of course, but I excuse myself because it's not going to help anything. And again, thank you for the hearts. Keep tapping the screen. Appreciate you. All right, you guys ready for number three? So number one was pay attention to their behavior. Number two was to observe how they treat others. And I will gladly, when we're all said and done, answer any questions that you have. But if you have a couple that come up in between, you can go ahead and ask me. If it's not going to take me too long, I'll answer. Oh, yeah. We got to have some music going on in the background. I'll drive myself crazy if I don't. So let's go. Number three. You ready for number three, guys? Put a three in the chat while you're rocking out with me. Come on. And while you're tapping the screen. And you will hear me remind you of that. There's a three. Come on. Let's get 10 threes. There's one. Come on. There's two. Three, four. Come on. Hey, there's five. Come on. Let's get five more. And some of these you're going to know, the list you're going to know, but again, we're here to have that comment. Thank you. Mystic just put a bunch of threes up. There we go. All right, number three. And y'all know this one, but I'm going to give it to you anyway. Notice how they talk about their exes. No, pay attention to how they talk about their exes. Number three, notice how they talk about their exes. Please make note. How someone talks about them can reveal a lot about their emotional maturity and how they handle relationships. Emotional maturity is super important, guys. And just because you're a certain age does not make you emotionally mature. I know some 55, 60-year-olds out here thinking they're 18 and 20. Not a good look. Not a good look. Don't be the old person at the club. You can be at the club, enjoy yourself, but don't be out there because you done messed up. Because it's not a good look. Sometimes us old heads got to just play our spot in the club and just chill and let these young folks have their space, man. We had ours. That's all. I'm not saying don't go to the club. I'm saying don't think you still dominating the club. Just enjoy your regal status. Like, I enjoy the gray. When I'm in a spot, I'm an OG. And I'm okay with that. I ain't that young dude no more. But please pay attention to how somebody talks about their ex. Because they had an emotional connection to... Yes, I'm old school and I love it. I embrace it. And if you're old school with me, let's go. But the reason why you pay attention to how somebody talks about their ex, remember, they had an emotional connection with that person. Possibly a sexual one. Whatever it is. There's emotional connection. And if it got negative, no matter whose fault, if they're now running them down, why? It's over. I can't shake it at 67. Nah, we got to get that smooth two-step. You shake it too much, we're going home and go to sleep afterwards. So we got to get the fly two-step. This is us right here. Stay right here. Stay right here. We ain't got to do all that extra. And then just shake your butt a little bit. See, that's the over 50 move. You ain't got to do a little hip. If your hips ain't bothering you, because you know knees is an issue when we get over 50. And the head and shoulders. You give them that and you looking good and smelling good, you good. You all right. So you got to give them. When I go out, I'm good. I put the Jean Paul Gaultier on. I look good. I'm with my wife. I'm good. So you're going to get a smooth two-step. And I get it. Go ahead, Pops. Yeah, I'll take all that. I ain't trying to work the dance floor no more. Just give me my little space. I'm good. Even if they downgrade the ex-wife. Listen, do not allow. Don't get into joining them with tearing down the ex. Pay attention to what they're saying about the ex, because it's going to tell you some things about what's going on. Now, me, when somebody starts to tear down their ex, I'm going to ask, but what did you do about that? Or how did you get past that? Because I want to know if there was some learning or some growing going on. Did they heal? Because if they're tearing down their ex and they're not healed and they're now with you, who you think gonna catch the brunt of all the foolishness with them? Male or female? So when somebody's tearing down their ex, please pay attention to that, because they're giving off something that you're gonna have to deal with. Now, hopefully you won't become the ex. Hopefully y'all will have something solid. But when somebody's tearing down their ex, please pay attention to that. There's something to be learned from that. Especially if it's venomous. If it's venomous, then there's some healing not done there. And again, if you're here in the group and you're new, thank you. I am Keith K.L. Belvin, crisis specialist, human service counselor, author. And every Friday we're here. What if they avoid all the questions? Don't ask me nothing. Then leave them alone. If you can't talk to me, if you're trying to get with me and you don't want to talk about things that make you who you are, we have no future. Because you're not healed yet. Go heal and then come back. And if I'm free, cool. You don't owe anybody anything unless you're married. If you're not married, remember, we're talking about when dating. My best friend's boyfriend told, well, that's a bad move. If a venomous snake bite you, could God save you? Yes. Yes, God could. But if you don't believe in God, then that question is a setup question. Because if you don't believe in God, you're going to tell me how. I believe in God, but I'm not going to get into that debate with you. Like I said, see, we believe in two different things, so there's no debate there. If you don't believe it, cool, I do, we're good. That's all, and we're okay to be on both sides of the platform. But again, guys, please pay attention to that, because again, a person will give away where certain things are with them. How about a boyfriend or girlfriend? Do you owe them? No. You owe them respect, cordiality, and conversation and communication and conversation. You owe a person that you're dating to be cordial with them. You owe a person that you owe a boyfriend or girlfriend respect. And you should be able to communicate. That you do owe, yes. Do I believe in karma? No. Because I believe that as a person grows and learns, they can change. But I do believe there's a price to pay for negative behavior. So I guess in a way, I do believe in the idea of karma. Karma itself, no. But I do believe that we pay for what we put out into the universe. But I believe a person can change. And I believe a person can come to a different mindset to then be of a positivity when they once were a negative. I am an example of it. But there are prices that I had to pay for the behaviors that I had the first 37 years. The last 18 doesn't erase that. The last 18 allows me to do things differently, but there is a price to pay for the behavior I had before that. Why do you think there's so much emphasis on so-called romantic relationships? Well, because romance makes us feel good. And romance does a lot for the individuals that's involved. And you want a relationship that has, if it is a romantic relationship, you want it to be of a high level. And when you lose that, it hurts. And so people are going to have that conversation. But all relationships are different because we have different connections to different people for different reasons. I told my fiance, hold on a second. I told my fiance that's none of my business about his ex-wives. Y'all can have conversations about him, but you want to pay attention if he's running them down, if he's has issues and things like that. You should have conversations about a person's ex because you want to know what a person's pathway is or was to get to you. There's nothing wrong with that. It's best pay attention to how the conversation is going. People of a higher level of frequency are going to have conversations about their past and it not turn into something negative. But you want to listen and pay attention to, hey, you guys are forgetting to tap that screen over there. What's going on over here? It's a red flag if you're meeting for the first time and they don't want to meet you halfway. Yeah, if the person is demanding that you come see them, that could be an issue too. But I would ask why. Is there a problem with us meeting halfway? If you don't want a relationship or dating, are you a healed person? No way to answer that question without knowing where you are right now, what your thoughts on it. So there's no way for me to answer that question. A person may not want to date simply because they just don't want to be involved in that right now. Some people may not want to date because they're hurt. So there's no way of knowing that without knowing the person. Is it wrong to keep secrets? That's a great question. When you say secrets, are we talking about what type of secrets are you talking about? Because I believe it's wrong to keep secrets that you know could hurt the other person. I believe y'all should try to be as honest as possible. But I do know realistically that people do keep secrets. He runs them down. Runs who down? I missed that. I'm sorry. Okay. Well, no, if he runs them down, that's a problem. Because again, that should say something too. And you should ask him why. Why do you run them down? If y'all are not together, why are you running down? Even if you had bad experiences with a person. I had some bad experiences in my past. I'm not going to run down the mothers of my children because I know what I was when I was younger. I know what I was in certain relationships. But there's nothing to gain running a person down. Nothing. And it also means that you're still tied to something there, to pain or something. If you feel the need to downgrade or do somebody verbally dirty who you're no longer with. I'm good. My ex-wife is the mother of my children. There's no reason for me to do her dirty. And I have other children with other women. I don't run them down because at the end of the day, if I know I wasn't perfect, why should it matter? I had a manager once say it's wrong to keep secrets. No, sometimes you need to keep a secret if when you expose it, it's going to hurt the person worse than the secret itself. And again, that's a great question, Ronan, because we'd have to know what the secret is, who the person is, and the situation at the time that we're having that conversation. So that's a great question, Ronan. I appreciate you asking that. All right, so we have three in the books. You guys ready for number four? And I love the conversation, but y'all got to tap this screen now. Y'all better stop playing. This is how y'all let me know that y'all are enjoying yourselves here and y'all are playing right now. I'll answer the questions. I got you, but y'all better tap that screen. Let's go. And let's go. Put those fours up. Let's keep it moving, guys. Come on. Here we go. believe. Come on. All right. There we go. I like that look right there. That's a good streaming heart right there. Love it. Love it. Okay. And again, y'all know some of these here, but again, I want to be able to have that conversation with you. Number four, watch inconsiderate behavior. Watch for inconsiderate, inconsistent behavior. If a person's not consistent, pay attention to that. Inconsistent behavior can be a red flag because if someone is unreliable or they have something to hide, their behavior will not be consistent. Pay attention to that. Pay attention to that if their words don't line up with their actions, or if one day they do one thing and the next day they don't do it. Pay attention to that, because if a person's unreliable, do you really want to be in a relationship with them? Do you really want to date somebody that's not reliable? If the company you work for was unreliable with paying you, would you go to work? If the bus you were trying to ride was unreliable and didn't show up at the time it said it was supposed to show up, would you still be out there waiting for the bus? If you're not consistent, accept my resist. I like that. Come on, Manny. Come on. If you're not consistent, expect my resist. Let's go. So just think about it. If you went to a restaurant and the food wasn't consistently good, if it wasn't reliable, you wouldn't eat there. So why would we accept those type of behaviors, inconsistent behaviors from people that we're trying to date? Remember, this is your life. This is you opening up and possibly letting somebody get closer to you with the idea of building something. Why would I want someone who's inconsistent and showing me those inconsistencies early? Nah, it's time to go at that point. There's 7.4 billion people on this planet. Don't you trip on no one person ever. Y'all better, you know what, y'all, and I know y'all writing some of this stuff down, but y'all, when y'all finish writing, come back over here and do this. You better stop playing. Send it to the left. See, the song actually, and I didn't have a playlist scheduled. It just comes up like that. I'm on YouTube. See the Lord working today. Know about me. Thank you, Sherry. I appreciate you. There we go. I appreciate it. Thank you for the hearts, guys. I'm trying to be entertaining. And we're almost at number five. At number five, we're going to hang out, listen to the music. I'll ask a couple of questions, and we'll get right back to the list. That's the imposter that showed up fight. That's the imposter that showed up fighting with the real person. Who's that, Q? You lost me with that one, Q. Who are we talking about? And welcome here, Angie. Appreciate you. Q, what are you referring to? That's the imposter that showed up fighting with the real person. I don't know what that's connected to. You have to help me out with that. Can I play something by Marvin G? Who's Marvin G? Because I'm not playing anything. I just chose, what is this, R&B 90s and 2000s. I don't even know what the playlist is. But who's Marvin G? Queen? Not know about me. Because I just pick whatever I'm on YouTube. The person not, okay, let me go back. The person not being consistent. Hold on, I got a phone call. Okay, yes, got you, Q. Okay, now I got it, because I just want to make sure, because I never want to respond without understanding where I'm going. Oh, Marvin Gaye, I got you. Yeah, I can go Marvin Gaye in a little bit. Let me go back and find something in a second. I'm a big Marvin Gaye fan, by the way. Great lyrics to his music, by the way. Any particular song by Marvin Gaye you want to hear? Before I go back to this, anybody? And I'm not taking requests. And you know what? Hold on, let me stop right there. If I start taking one request, all of a sudden I'm going to have, you know what? Maybe one Marvin Gaye song, and then I'm going to come back to my list here, because I realized I did that before, and all of a sudden I got 9,000 on what's name. All right, so here we go. So we got number four. Real quick, pay attention to their behavior was number one. Observe how they treat others, number two. Notice how they talk to their exes, number three. Watch for inconsistent behavior, number four. So let's go to number five. Put five. Let me get 10 fives in the chat. Hey, thank you, Marla. I appreciate you being here. And I thank whoever sent you to be here. Can I take some requests? We'll see. I'm not really in DJ mode right now, because y'all not tapping the screen. I don't see enough hearts for me to start taking music requests. Y'all playing. I'm making heart requests, and some of y'all ignoring me. Now I'm going to be a little baby. Hey, look at this. Breakfast is served. Thank you. Who sent that? Hey, thank you, Lady Perkins. I like the classic breakfast, too. And I haven't eaten. You know what's funny is I don't eat till 12 o'clock because I intermittent fasting. And I don't eat till 12. So, actually, a lot of times when I'm here, I haven't eaten. So, I got to eat around 1:30, 2 o'clock. So, I'm starving when we get done. But I appreciate you. If you're new, let us know. Your finger hurts. Got you, Chloe. Sorry about that. If you're new, let me know where you're checking in from. We'd like to be able to greet you the right way. I am Keith K.L. Belvin, Crisis Specialist, Human Service Counseling. Every Friday, we are here from 11:30 to 1 o'clock or 11:30 to 1:30, depending on how the conversation is going. Shay from Brooklyn. Hey, that's right. I taught in Bed-Stuy. My wife is from Brownsville, and I'm originally from South Jamaica, Queens, New York, but I spent almost 27 years in Brooklyn. My sons are in Brooklyn right now, Marine Park. Hey, shout out from Mississippi. Hey, New Jersey down the Turnpike, bro. I used to live in Salem County. Graduated from Pensgrove High School, class of 85. I got kicked out of New York for being a bad kid. I went to four different high schools in New York and then got sent down to South Jersey. Shout out to Harlem. I used to teach at 126 in Amsterdam, right next to the bus. Yes, I've done a lot. Harlem World, stand up. But yeah, I taught at the school right there next to the Jackie Gleason bus depot. Right there on 126 in Amsterdam. There's like four different schools inside the building now. Shout out from Oregon. All right, so we got the fives. All right, appreciate you. Let's go to number five, guys. Okay, here we go. Number five, I'm in PA, living in North Carolina. I'm supposed to come to do a wedding in North Carolina next month in Charlotte. Let's go. Number five on the 10 ways to identify red flags when dating. Pay attention to their communication style. Pay attention to the way that they communicate with you and with other people. Watch how they talk with you, how they talk to other women, how they talk to other men. Watch their communication style. Communication is an essential part of any relationship. And paying attention to someone's communication style can help you identify red flags that may be there. Watch how they speak. I'm originally from Brooklyn, Bed-Stuy. I moved to North Carolina in 94. Came back 2 years ago to care. Got you. I used to be right there. What was that? MS 534. And I used to teach at the junior high school upstairs. An over-talkative person who becomes impatient when other people is talking. I'd have to go check, Nikki. I don't know off the top of my head what the clinical term is. Forgive me for not knowing that. And if you know, please share. Please share. I'm always open to learn something. What happens if the great communication but horrible at everything else? You have to make a decision if that person is for you. Remember, you don't accept one part that's good and accept all the negative. If the person does not make you happy, just because they have one aspect that's positive, there's no reason to be with them. A person, and I'm not saying they got to be perfect, but they at least should be well-rounded. Y'all can work on some things. Hey, my aunt's from Queens. Yes, my sisters live out there. Oh, Keith, I'm mad. Okay, well, I'll look at that. I will definitely check. Because a lot of times when you got to understand this, and you might be, but just document it and pay attention to that. And back to Nikki. Let me just say this, Nikki. A person over-talking or being talking a lot, you got to be careful because that might be their style. And it may be very genuine, or they may be nervous and talk a lot. There's a lot there. So like I said, I would have to know or get more information to truly dig into that. And Marla, with a narcissist, you'll notice if everything is directed back to them. Thank you so much. I appreciate that, Authentics. The narcissist will move everything about them. And I don't want to talk politics, but if you look at our former president, he's a super narcissist. And a super narcissist is somebody that no matter what's going on in the world, it's got to be about them. So if you pay attention to him, no matter what he's called on, he'll deny it. Even when you know, you're like, we just saw you do that. Nope. And a super narcissist will not take ownership of anything that's negative, but wants to take ownership of everything positive. Please pay attention to that in their life because they will throw you off the cruise ship and say you jump just so they can get the attention, or they'll throw you off the cruise ship, jump in and save you, and then say, hey, I don't know what's wrong with them, but good thing I was here just to get the accolades. Be careful of that. Good morning, Montana. Hey, how are you today? Be careful if you're dealing with a narcissist, but please make sure that you do your homework first to know if you're actually dealing with a narcissist. You don't want to just throw that out there and you're not sure if you are. Okay, so here's the thing. We've gotten to the halfway point. We have five of the books. I'm going to go back over to five. We're going to take about a 30-second break and listen to some music. And what I want you to do in that 30 seconds, so you have nothing to write, you're going to tap the screen. But before we do that, let me go back over the five. And again, shout out to everybody. Live with a super narcissist. There you go. Shout out to everybody that's here. If you break up with someone and they send a message breaking up with you. If you break up with somebody, then they send a message breaking up with you. Isn't that manipulation? That's a form of manipulation, but I would just ignore it. If you've already cut them off, don't drive yourself crazy. A person who talks about themselves in the description of a narcissist, but talks about themselves and then doesn't want to hear you talk about you. Be careful of that. When a person wants to talk about themselves and then you go to say something about you and they go, I don't have time for that. I don't do all that talking. But you just did. Be mindful of that. All right, so number one, on the 10 ways to identify red flags when dating, number one was pay attention to their behavior. Number two was observe how they treat others. Number three was notice how they talk about their exes. Number four was watch for inconsistent behavior. Number five was pay attention to their communication style. All right, so here we go. We're going to hang out for 30 seconds. I'll just be keeping an eye on the chat for a little bit. But let's tap this screen and let's enjoy the music here. Y'all wanted Marvin Gaye? Okay, I'm going to give some Marvin Gaye. Let's go with, let's see what we got here. Let's go and Let's Get It On. Let's go and Let's Get It On. And while we listen to Marvin Gaye, I want y'all to tap the screen. Only what's dealing with narcissists is to avoid all. Yes, because unless they're getting serious help, they're not going to change. All right, here we go. Now, I'm not taking any more requests, but I'm a Marvin fan. So while Marvin is singing to us, I need y'all to tap the screens, and I'll be looking at if there's any questions that pop up. And if you feel like I feel, come on. Thank you so much for that. I appreciate the hand heart. Woo. Yes. And if anybody needs any information... That auto tapper key said I should advance. It really has. Okay. I got you. Let's get it on. How can I really find out if he's really married? Do a background search. You can pay for him now. Hey, thank you. Appreciate that. People with so much to give. Come on now. It is so easy to find. No, I can't sing. I may sound like Barry White, but I can't sing like him. Hey, thank you so much. I appreciate the confetti. And as soon as Marvin is finished singing, we'll get back to the list. My guy says he doesn't say I love you because he wants to show me. You tell him that you would like to hear it too. Say I appreciate you. Thank you for the heart. I mean the rose. Tell him I appreciate you, what you do for me. But I would love to hear it sometime because a person loves to hear quality words as well as feel quality action. That's all. Because you don't want to lose that he's doing things for you, but you also want him to be able to express that. Yeah, miss that dude. It's sad that his own father took him off this planet. Come on, y'all. Let's rock out. Now, if Marvin don't get y'all to give up hearts, I don't know what to give you. Thank you so much for the rose. To get it on with me. Woo. I ain't gonna push, woo, push it, baby. Come on. And we'll get back to the list in a minute. Come on, rock out. Where are my old heads at? Y'all know y'all digging this. Come on. Come on, here we go. Woo. Get on. Come on. You know what I'm talking about. Come on, baby. Come out with you, and I'm not one of them old heads that hates today's music, so please stop doing that. Please stop saying, yo, your kids today don't make music like they used to. Yes, they do. You just have to know how to hear it. Because I'm a music junkie. There's some good songs out today. We're just drugged out by what we like. We We need that. There's a time and a place. There we go. Come on, keep tapping. There we go. Almost done. Come on. As soon as Marvin finishes, we'll get back to the list, guys. And again, I am Keith Kale Bovin, and I am glad all of you are here. You could be anywhere in the world. I'm glad you're spending some time with us here. Not good to keep secrets, but, well, it depends, again, what the secret is, what it'll do to the person if you find out. But at some point, everything needs to be revealed at some point. And that's a tough one. That's a very tough question. Come on, come on, come on, darling. Stop me round the bush. Woo! You gotta get it on. Ooh, and you, baby, I want to get it on. Come on. You don't have to worry that it's wrong. If the spirit moves you, let me groove you. Love come down. Excuse me. All right, here we go. Actually, we finish up. We got, 30 seconds? Okay, we'll finish last 30 seconds. Garden, okay, you have to. Also, you have to be careful that giving somebody something that's going to destroy them, you got to be careful. And that's a tough one. Like I said, as a counselor, that's a tough one. My students listen to you. Hey, shout out to Jay. My kids love music in the classroom. Hey, I'm a former educator, guys. I was a dean, so if you got sent to my office, you already know. All right, so let me just switch this here. All right, we'll go with a little 70s vibe today.
Here's why.
All right, so we're going to get back to the list. Let me just get this started first and get my music straight. There we go. These commercials coming. Alone. All right, so here we go. So let's reset the room. Let's get things back on track now. Again, if anybody has joined us that's new, how do you cultivate a healthy blended family? That is a great question. Actually, if you go to my YouTube page, I did a whole conversation. I was invited to talk about blended families. One, make sure that everyone has a voice. Sit down and discuss everything that you bring together as a blended family. And also make sure that you literally are discussing what that's going to look like before you actually merge the family. Don't just throw your children together and say, hey, deal with it because I love this person. It's something that should be worked on. But actually, if you go to my YouTube page, you'll see the video where it says dealing with blended families. I did a whole live Zoom on that. I was invited to come speak. I think the church was in Maryland, where I did a whole thing on blended families. It's on my YouTube page, so you can go check it out. And if you have any other questions after that, come back and let me know. I'll gladly answer those for you. All right, so let me just stop this real quick. Let me reset the room. So again, anybody that's here that's new, thank you for being here. I am Keith K.L. Belvin, Crisis Specialist, Human Service Counselor. Every Friday from 11:30 to 1 o'clock, 1:30, whatever time we finish. This is what we do. Right now, we are discussing 10 ways to identify red flags when dating. We did 5 already. We're about to go to number 6. So with that said, I want 10 sixes in the chat, and you guys keep tapping the screen, and let's get to business now. Let's get back to work. All right, so let's get 10 sixes in the chat. Hey, Perfect, I'm like, where's she at? She's the one that, and there's the shout out to Perfectly Imperfect. She's the one that actually asked me to put this list together. So let's get 10 sixes, and we're going to move on to number 6. And again, I want to thank you for being here because, again, you could be anywhere on the planet, but you're here with me. And that's not by accident. I don't believe in accidents, and I don't believe in coincidences. I'm a man of faith. I believe things happen for a reason. Even if it doesn't show itself at the beginning, it will. 12. Really? 2 sixes? Really, Chloe? That's what we're doing? All right, here we go. Number 6. Turn this down just a little bit. Number 6 in the 10 ways to identify red flags. Be aware of financial situations. Woo, Lord, let me say that again. Be aware of financial situations. Financial problems can strain any relationship. Be aware if this person is broke and you are not. Or be aware if this person doesn't handle money well and it's going out like water. Be careful and pay attention to that. Now, just because a person is broke does not mean that it is a red flag. They might have had bad situations, but that is a conversation. You need to have a conversation on how you deal with money. What's your thoughts on money? What do you plan on doing with money? What are we going to do with our money separately? Remember, you're dating. You're not married. But you want to know what a person's financial situation is. Be aware of it. I will be back. Have to go. Okay, well, thank you for being here as long as you were, Angie. I appreciate you. God willing, we'll be here next Friday. But yes, you want to pay attention and don't be scared to have a conversation about finances. If a person was going through something, the person went through a bad divorce, a bad breakup, if the person had money stolen from them, if the person had bad business dealings, talk about it. Because if they're honest with themselves and you, they will explain to you what they're doing now because of any situation that they're going through. First thing a guy asked me was, "You're well off, aren't you?" For me, yes. Why do you ask? Yes, I am. For me, why do you ask? Nothing wrong with being frugal. I'm frugal. I ain't trying to give it away. My wife says I'm cheap. And I said, that's so offensive. She said, I don't care. You cheap. I'm like, but I spend. She's like, and here's the funny thing is, and she's not talking about with her and my daughter, with myself. She's like, you don't spend any money on yourself. Should women set high financial standards? No, men and women should. Everybody should have high financial standards, not just women, men and women. Because in the end of the day, you want to be okay. Yeah, I'm cheap with myself. I'm like, I don't spend a lot of money on myself. I don't. My wife actually had to convince me to go spend some money. But I have learned to listen to my wife, which is one of the things I teach the brothers. Listen to your wife. But yes, your financial situation, especially when you're single, you should always have high financial understanding, even if you don't have the extra money. And the reason why is because just because you don't have it doesn't mean that you shouldn't learn what to do with it when it comes. We should always be thinking progressive. I knew when I left my ex-wife back in 2000, I knew that if I left her with the debt, it would create a negative for her because I knew she didn't handle money well. So I took the $28,000 in debt, which freed her up to go buy a house, a car, and the other thing. So some people was like, yo, you played yourself. No, I didn't. I put my boys in a better situation because I knew that their mother wasn't good with money. She wound up losing the car and was almost about to lose the house. But that's not my concern. My concern was I had a somewhat good understanding of finances. It hurt. It took me almost 10 years to get out from that financial situation. My credit score was like 560 at that time because of the damage and the hit and everything like that. Took me 10 years, and then after the 10 years, I was able to not only restart everything, that now I'm 750, 760. So your financial literacy should be growing, even if the money is not there now. It will come. Good afternoon. Yes, my wife had to convince me to spend money myself. Yeah, I'm getting better, Jerome. I'm getting better. We all should strive to achieve physical, mental, emotional, financial. Very true. Come on, Ellie. He showed interest in talking to me by him asking. It threw me off because he's broke. Well, why is he broke? And he should be able to express why things are not where he wants them to be financially. But then what he should also explain to you, Nick, is what's his plan? Because here's the thing. If you have intelligence about something and he starts to explain to you his plan, and his plan makes a whole lot of sense, you go, you know what? That's a great plan. Well, you might be inclined to help him, not financially give him money, but be able to help smooth out some understandings to help him recover if the reason why he broke is something that made sense. That's why we have to have these financial situations and conversations, because I need to know how you got to this point. And if I don't know how you got to this point, why would I? And I used to say this to my mom. Let me just explain something. I'm the last person you want to borrow money from. I'll tell you why. You're going to pay me back. I don't play that. Even my own mom's, when she was here, rest her soul, and my grandmother too, I'm going to miss them both this weekend. When my mother would borrow money, she would say before she even borrowed it, I know, I got to pay you back. Okay. And she said, why are you like that? And I would say this to her. If I allow you to owe me and I don't want it back, I lose the ability to not only help you in the future, but to help anybody else. You cannot place me in a hole, Mom, because you need. I am here to help, but I need it back. One, by giving it to you, my money is now asleep for me. When you give money to somebody else, your money is asleep to you. You don't make any money on it. You don't make any interest on it. None of that. But once it comes back, you now have leverage to do what you want to do or what you need to do, whatever, as well as whether you want to gain interest, whatever it is. But once you lend money, there should be an understanding of when it's going to come back. I'm just saying. How long should we wait for his plan to come to fruition? Whose plan? Who's playing? I don't understand the question. You got to give me more clarity on what you're asking. Who's playing and what is it connected to? Is it a religious question? You have to give me more context to the question, Candy, and I'll gladly answer that. My hubby helped me to bring my credit score from, okay, after 5 years job, paid it back. Nothing wrong with that. Yeah, but I wouldn't expect it back from a mom. Okay, and you're welcome to feel that way, Jerome. I don't, because the idea is just because she's my mom doesn't mean I just throw money out the window. Because she may need help in the future. And if I keep throwing money out the window, that hurts me and hurts everybody else connected to me. Don't allow a family member's position to make you believe that you got to throw money out the window just because y'all are family. Nah, I don't believe in that. Family does not have the right to make you broke because you're family. Now, I didn't say I didn't give it to her. I said I want it back. Which then makes her decide if what she's borrowing it from me for is worth it because she know how I am with money. There you go. With mom, I give no expectations, siblings. And that's okay. I have no problem with anybody who has that position. When it comes to money, I don't do that. And my mom understood because my mom was horrible with money. So why would I give to somebody who's already horrible with money and refuse to learn when I would try to teach her about money? I'm not going to give just because she's my mom, because then I can't cover her in the future. I can't work with someone who has a new plan every few months. Well, that's another reason why you talk about your financial situation. Because if a person, if it keeps changing, and that's what we talked about. Number four was watch for inconsistent behavior, Chloe, because that's inconsistent behavior. That's a tip off that somebody you might not want to rock with. So that's number four in its entirety. All right, way to go, guys. I love it, love it, love it. All right, let's go to number seven. Let's get 10 sevens in the chat. Come on, let's go. Put 10 sevens in the chat. And I know, like, it's funny. My wife would be the same way. My wife would say, send me $100. I go, why? And she go, here you go. I go, why? And she's like, just give me the money. She know I'm going to ask. And I give it to him and be like, yo, you got to give me that money back, man. Because, and again, it's what it's connected to. And she has her own play money to go do whatever. I don't question it. Do you? See, money can be an issue if you make it an issue. If you have open conversations and boundaries and understandings about money, money is not supposed to create the issues that it creates amongst people. The problem is we don't have great financial conversations or great boundaries with each other. So we wind up, it becomes a struggle. Money's not supposed to be, money's a tool, just like a hammer. I don't fight over the hammer if I know I got a nail in a nail. And if somebody borrows my hammer, I expect them to bring the hammer back, because then I can't nail it anything else if they take the hammer. We just put too much emotional connection to money. I don't. I am a generous to anyone until I see you playing me. Once you play me, stop. Yeah, well, that's true. But if I see how you playing others, I'm not going to wait for you to play me. I'm going to cut you off before you play me. Where my old heads at? We feeling it right now. Where my over 45? What is it, over 45? Where my over 50 cats in the chat? I think 45, you was a little young when this was out. Yeah, 45 might be a little young. But if you over 50, y'all know what Eddie LaVert was doing with this song. I'm sorry, I got sidetracked. See, that's why I don't play around music. Number seven. There we go. My age. I'll be 56 this year. There we go. Come on. Over 55. Here we go. All right. Number seven. Don't get me started, guys. I apologize. See, that's why I get sidetracked. Ellie, if I get sidetracked, Ellie, just say, hey, Keith, get back to work. What's going on over here? Really? This is what y'all doing to me here? We done talked about this, guys. Y'all going to stop playing with these hearts. What's up? There go one. Really? This is what y'all doing? I'm in my 30s and yes, come on, Claude. There we go. Nothing wrong with that. I'm not getting at you, young guys. Y'all okay. But it's one thing when you were out there when it was on, though, Claude. Thank you so much for the hearts. Here we go. Number seven. Notice how they handle conflict. Woo! Notice how they handle conflict, guys. When someone deals with conflict, it can be a significant indicator of how they handle disagreements in relationships. Watch how a person handles conflicts. If they flying off the handle because the waitress made a mistake with their food, pay attention to that. If they yelling and screaming at the Uber driver because he made a wrong turn or she made a wrong turn, pay attention to that. Pay attention to how they deal with conflicts. It will tip off a lot. Yes, I don't want to choose one over the other, Mystic, but that is a big one. So I got to agree with you there. That is a big one. I think they're all big, but this one here, because, and I listen, I've seen people walking up the street and I've seen a person do something and I look and go, I know that's going to be bad. And I'm not even saying it as a counselor. I'm saying it as a person watching somebody else. And I just see the person like, and I'm like, oh, I feel for that person. Because I'm like, if they're like this in public, you're speaking my life. It was, oh, I got you. Okay, Yolanda. Let me tell you something, guys. As an educator, right? This is something I paid attention to. I watched the way parents treated their children when they came up to my office to have a conversation. And sometimes I literally have to close my door and cry. Because I was like, if you treat your child like this where we can see you, what is that poor child getting when they go home? And I can't save them all. My first year of teaching, I thought I was going to drink myself into oblivion because I was so emotional over trying to figure out how I was going to help these kids out. And then I had to realize I can't save them all, but I'll do the damnedest that I can. But I still to this day get emotional when I see the way some parents treat their children in public, because my fear is, what are you doing to them in the house? What are you doing to them when nobody can see? And then that extended to everybody. When I see the way men and women interact with each other, when I see the way a man might treat a woman, when I see the way a woman might treat her man, when I see the way two women get at it, two men, I don't care who you are. When I see a person just treating a person badly in public, I always worry about what that person is dealing with at home. But I got to remember, my place is my place, and my place is not to try to heal or fix everybody, so I don't. Because you put yourself in a lot of dangerous situations trying to fix other people who did not ask you to fix them. Parents really take where you act up is where you get... Well, they're not supposed to... I had one of those parents. Yeah, my mom did not care. Come take him away. I'm going to beat him anyway. Keith, would you intentionally create a stressful situation? Yes, I've done that in the past when I was trying to manipulate or when I was in my manipulation mode. A lot of manipulators do that. A lot of narcissists do that. Some will manipulate you in that way just so you'll kick them out of the house so they can go be with the next person. Some will do that because they like drama and they feed off of drama. Some people get off on drama. They get off on seeing you all flustered, male or female. Be careful of individuals like that. Be careful of people who seem to get excited about your pain. Be careful of that. Yeah, my mom believed in the belt, the extension cord, the slipper, the shoe, whatever it was. And when I got older and I was taller than her, it was the broomstick. And when that didn't work, she called my uncles to come rough me off. All right, Ellie, thank you so much. Ellie, I know you said you had to go, so we're going to rock out without Ellie. And before Ellie goes, everybody, purple hearts for Ellie before she goes to start her weekend. Let's say goodbye to Ellie and the wonderful work that she do. We're going to take it from here, so I'm going to have a whole room full of moderators. Let's give, yes, and the switch. Let's give purple hearts for Ellie before she goes and tell her thank you for the wonderful job she does as a moderator here. So, and we're going to rock out without Ellie the rest of the way. Clothesline, I've had that one too. Cat and Nine Tails, if you know what it is, you know. Switch, I would come back in with a little tiny piece of stick and she go, oh, you know what? You playing with me. She go out there and get a whole tree branch and beat me with it. I had Southern parents. A fork, oh Lord. I had Southern parents. And I had Southern women of color where abuse was just built into the cake. Aunts beat me. Grandma beat me. Mom beat me. All right, Ellie. Have a wonderful day, love. Appreciate you. Man, and then my uncles, they didn't understand that a whipping is supposed to stop like after you pass out. They beat you till you pass out and then keep beat. Then get mad that you passed out and beat you some more. And if ain't this sounds strange, listen, in the 70s, 60s and 70s and families of color, let me tell you something. You ain't understand it. It don't take a village to beat us all. They took that to heart. It takes a village to raise a child. They forgot what the rest of that statement was. It takes a village to raise a child. It don't take a village to beat the sense out of them. Yeah, that lecture after really didn't have no effect. You know why I beat you? Because you crazy. Ah, you get it again. And when you're sitting there crying and in pain, all you're hoping is that they just drop off the planet. I don't care why you beat me. I'm hurt. Yeah, just look. Can I cry this out first? You done tore my behind up, and now you want to come in and tell me, you know I love you. You don't love me. Keep tapping that screen, guys. Let's go. All right, so, but it's super important. Please pay attention to how, there you go. Has to be right. Yes, I'm trying to think. That talk to him, Montana. Talk to him. All right, so we got, let me reset the room real quick because we just said goodbye to Ellie. So again, if this is your first time here, I am Keith K.L. Belvin, crisis specialist, human service counselor, author, educator, and I'm here to try to entertain, educate, and to inform. Today we're talking about 10 ways to identify red flags when dating. They just beat me. Just leave it alone. Just tell me go in my room after the beating. So let me just recap real quick, and then we're going to knock down these last three, and I will gladly engage you in any conversation that you want. All right, so the 10 ways to identify red flags. Let's just go back over the list, and here's what I need. You guys are going to be my moderators as we go. So as I give them, I'll slow down a little bit. Throw them in the chat for anybody who either got here late or may come in and want to go back over the chat. All right, so let's just recap and get up to number 8, and we're good to go. 10 ways to identify red flags when dating. Number 1, pay attention to their behavior. Somebody throw that in the chat for me. Pay attention to their behavior. Number 1. Or if you know them, you know what I'm going to do. Throw it in the chat before I get there if you've already written them down. Number 2, observe how they treat others. Number 3, notice how. Let me just move this up. Thank you, perfect, imperfect. Number 3, notice how they talk to their exes. So number 2, observe how they treat others. Number 3, notice how they talk about their exes. Thank you. Thank you, guys. I appreciate you. That's how we're going to do it. We're going to show the village in action right now. Number 4, watch for inconsistent behaviors. And if you already know, you have your list, just go ahead and toss it in there. Be ready when I get to that number. You're good to go. I just want to make sure everybody has the list and ready to go. So number 4, watch for inconsistent behaviors. Number 5, pay attention to their communication style, how they talk. And watch how that changes. That's a big one, because true manipulators know how to inflect the right way. We know how to, and I say we because I used to be a manipulator, we know how to bring out certain emotions to get what we want. Pay attention to that. And because I used to be the wolf, now I'm the shepherd, I know how the wolf moves. Trust me when I tell you. I'm speaking from experience. I'm not speaking from something that I studied in school. This is something that I lived. And so a lot of times what I'm trying to help you is not just what I learned in school, what I know to be true. And I'll gladly, like I said, answer any questions. So pay attention. Number 6, be aware of their financial situation. Somebody coming with empty pockets, be careful if they're now trying to fill those pockets with your money and making you feel a certain way just so they can get what they want. But pay attention. Have that conversation. Don't be scared to discuss their financial situation. Don't be scared to discuss your own. I wish I had had more financial situation. The money I gave away out here chasing panties between the hot sheet motels and the regular hotels and the dinners and the drinking and the clothes and everything else just to try to get some. If I had a tenth of that back, I'd be wealthy. Number 7, pay attention to how they handle conflict. So number 7 is notice how they handle conflict. And that should put us all up to date. Okay, you guys ready? Y'all with me? Y'all awake? Y'all good? All right, so to my 70s babies, I'm going to change the flow here a little bit. We're going to change the music a little bit. I know my 70s babies was dealing with the music, but we're going to change this a little bit. Let's see what we got here. All right, we're going to go with, the year was 2003. We're going to go back just 20 years. We're going to move it up a little bit. All right, let's go. Come on, Tyrese. Come on. Woo. Robbing you is knowing and you know what's up. There we go. Come on. Who was the one? Okay, here we go. So number 8. There we go. Come on. So let's put 8s in the chat. Let's go. Give me 8 8s in the chat. Come on. 8 8s in the chat. Let's get this going. Let's get this back to where we need to be. Come on. 8 8s. 88. Come on. Here we go. Let's get those 8s in the chat. How you gonna act like that? What I'm gonna... leave me now? How you gonna leave me now? How you gonna leave me after I put the money down on the house? How you gonna leave? All right, so number 8. Subtle one, but very important. Observe how they prioritize their time. Watch what they do with their time. Observe how they prioritize their time. Watch how they handle their time. When somebody prioritizes their time, how someone prioritizes their time can be a red flag for their commitment to a relationship. If a person doesn't take time serious, you have to be very careful, because then your expectations of somebody being there for you would be a little off. On the house we ball. How a person deals with time. Let me let you in a little secret from me. And I got this from Malcolm X when I was reading this book, and it just kind of stuck with me, right? I don't trust anybody that doesn't wear a watch or doesn't have a way to check their time. Now, I know most people do it on their phones now, and I got that. But I'm a little leery of anybody that doesn't pay attention to time. And if somebody's like, I don't care what time it is, and if you're always late, or you don't seem to care about other people's time, I pay attention to that. That's a red flag for me. If you don't care about somebody else's time, or you don't have a watch on, and I got a bunch of different watches. I got watches all over the place. What is this here? This is a Michael Kors watch here. All right, and then I got another watch here. Listen, depending on where I'm going, what I'm doing, I keep watches around me, depending on what I'm doing. And the reason why is because I always have to have some type of timepiece on me, because I'm not taking my phone out every time to check the time. I'm not knocking people that do. I knock people that don't pay attention to time. I got a problem with that. But number 8, observe how they prioritize their time. Turn it down just a little bit. But that's super important, guys. Let me ask you a question. How is that with you? Is yes if it's an issue, no if it isn't when it comes to time. They feel restricted. Okay, I got you, Jose. So put a yes if you have an issue with somebody who doesn't prioritize, or no if it doesn't bother you. Like, hey, that's just them. If it doesn't bother you, put no in the chat. If it bothers you, put yes. I just want to get a feel for where you guys are when it comes to time. Because I don't like to see people waste anybody's time. I definitely don't like to have my time wasted. Even with my counseling sessions, you have 15 minutes. If I don't hear you in 15 minutes? Both? How both, Sherry? How is it both for you, Sherry? That's an interesting answer. Yes, it bothers me, and I'm on time ahead of time. There you go. If you're supposed to come over and time goes without a call or text or your ETA, I have to call you. I got you. I'm already there. I got you. With my counseling sessions, you got 15 minutes. If I don't hear from you or see you or you tell me in 15 minutes, that's it. I'm out. I cut off the link and I'm going on about my business, because at that point, it is what it is. I'm retired, so I understand being chill, but being chronically late is disrespect. And that's an issue. That's a conversation. We're going to rock out the Tyrese today. So we got a bunch of Tyrese songs today. So we're going to go with Tyrese right now. So yeah, I'm glad y'all appreciate that. Sherry, you didn't tell me, Sherry, you said both. I wanted to get an idea of what you mean by both. That's interesting to me. I'm already mad. Come on. And while we're waiting on Sherry to respond, we're going to go to number 9. You guys ready? Let's get 9 9s. Let's get 9 9s in the chat, and let's go with number 9. When you need me. If you need to be on time, like during the week, but weekend I'm lazy, not caring about time. Okay, I got you. I can respect that. Okay, so yeah, that would be both. Now, hopefully, I'm not waiting on you the weekend, because I'd be like, where's Sherry at? You know what? I ain't messing with her. But I respect that answer. I appreciate that, Sherry. Thank you. And that's another reason, guys, we just can't project how we feel. Ask other people why they feel the way they feel. Don't just automatically project your feelings out to them and go, what? That's stupid. Da, da, da. Okay, we can agree to disagree on things. We can feel differently, because many times we do. And then ask for clarity. Just say, hey, could you explain that to me? Because I don't move that way, but could you explain it how it moves for you? And that allows you to build not just an understanding, it allows you to open up a dialogue that helps you learn about other people, which then could help you in the long run when you meet people like that particular person. So it's super important. Communication is important, though. Be late, but tell me. Yeah, exactly. And again, that's a conversation that has to be had, Chloe. Call me and text me or something. That's why I said with no contact, with my counseling sessions. If I don't have no contact, if you text me and say I'm running a little behind, okay, if I don't have another session right behind you, I may push that session back. But you got to let me know something. You don't let me know nothing, then I got to cut you loose and charge you. And I'd rather not do that. I'd rather have the session. I enjoy talking to people. All right, here we go. Give me 9-9s. We ready? Let's get 9-9s. Did I miss the 9s? Did we put 9s up and I miss it? Let's get 9-9s. Let's put those 9s in the chat. Come on. Get it on if you need me. I will be. And you'll be my sweet lady. Lady, would you be mine? Mine for a lifetime. Y'all don't understand, I played this song so much when I was at that late stages of my divorce, not divorce, actually separation, pending divorce. I wanted to get out the house so bad. This song, Chico DeBarge, just Listen to Your Man, and Lauryn Hill's X Factor, I had on rotation on record. I played this so much that my ex-wife came tearing out the room. I don't know what sweet lady you keep playing this song for, but you need to turn that crap off. And she didn't say crap. And I was like, I literally didn't say that. I just played a song. I was doing everything to drive her crazy because I was unhappy. She was unhappy. I literally played those three songs. And I know it was annoying. See, when you have ADD, I can play the songs over and over again. It don't bother me, but I know it was driving her crazy. I was doing it on purpose because I didn't know what to do. I was young and stupid, and we both was unhappy. And I literally was playing music that was getting on her nerves. I thought she's going to come out and just tear the whole stereo system up. And I'd have went to my pocket headphone at that point. And sometimes I was sitting at the computer with my headphones on, I'd be playing the song and singing it. So I know she was getting upset. Probably driving her crazy to see you happy. Yes. Yes. But, you know, the crazy part was when it was finally time to say it's over and leave, she's like, please don't go. And I was almost about to say, okay, we can work on it. And I was like, nah, that's not going to work. And no sooner did I say, no, it ain't going to work, woo, did the venom show up. Well, get the, oh, my God. But we needed to be apart. She wasn't a good wife. I wasn't a good husband. We should not have been married. And I don't put it on her because I was just as bad. I actually write about it in my book, From Gigolo to Jesus. When I look back at what I wasn't going to be a good husband to anybody. So I can't blame her for something that I wasn't prepared to be, which was a husband. And I talk about it in one of my books. I say, you know, no one gets married to end up divorced. And I was in a marriage. I wasn't married. And there's a difference. Please let me explain that. You could be in a marriage, but to be married means that you are committed to the other person, good and bad. Many of us were in or are in marriages, but we're not married because we don't understand. My time came later because I had to get out of a bad situation, heal, or be in the process of healing to even be able to accept and benefit from what came afterwards. So that's the reason why I try to explain to people, don't stay somewhere where you know you're hurting and then you're hurting somebody else. Get out of that, heal, and then you can become something to somebody else, or at least work on it anyway. All right, so with the 9s, here we go. Be aware of their emotional availability. Be aware of a person's emotional availability. Emotional availability is essential in any relationship. If a person cannot be there for you emotionally, then why are they with you? Because then is it just physical? Remember, the mental is how we think, the emotions is how we feel, and the spiritual is our spiritual positioning. If you don't have an emotional connection with somebody, a deeper internal connection with somebody, then what are you doing? And you got to be able to have that conversation. I think I'm different. If I'm in a relationship, I think I thought I was married. Well, you can't be married to somebody you didn't actually marry. Now, if you put marriage feelings on dating, that's something that you got to deal with. because you elevated something that didn't get there. You cannot elevate dating to marriage. It's two different things. Marriage is the commitment of forever. Dating is right now we're really cool with each other. We really enjoy each other. We might even have great sex, but we're dating. And depending on the boundaries that you put in place, we may not be exclusive if you didn't actually have that conversation. And I noticed that you guys are not tapping the screen. Y'all getting lazy because Ellie's not here. Y'all better tap that screen, stop playing. Really? Y'all just going to sit there and watch me and nobody's going to tap the screen or nothing? Really, that's what we're doing? This how y'all going to do me? I'm being the host, the DJ. I'm about to get up and start. No, I'm not going to dance. That's out. Hello, Ann. Welcome. And it's super important because emotional availability. Thank you so much for the hearts, guys. Appreciate you. The emotional availability is for both of you. You want to be able to be with a partner that you can pour into emotionally and that will receive that and then be the same. You can be the same for them. That bonding is what leads you to wanting to be married. But if a person is not making themselves emotionally available, that's a big red flag, because here's the other part. If they're making themselves available physically, if they're making themselves available to the bedroom, but they're not making themselves available when you need them emotionally, boop, 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 there's the red flag. Right, that's exactly what I did. I had to step back myself, realize that, did you say I do? Then he's not your husband. Did you say I do? He's not your wife. She's not your wife. If y'all didn't actually get married, that person, stop saying, yo, that's hubby, that's wifey. No, that's my girlfriend, that's my boyfriend. That's who I'm dating. My guy thinks I should already know where. No, you have to have that conversation. Also, please understand that often men and women think about dating differently. Women can date multiple people. It don't mean they sleeping with them. Men, unfortunately, many of us men, not all, when we hear dating, we think humping. So when a woman says, I'm dating four or five people, you should gotta go, word, really? Ew. Because they're already thinking humping. And my wife and I joke about this all the time. Where are you from? I'm sending you. Hey, I am from Delaware. Thank you for being here. Appreciate you. And my wife and I joke about that all the time. And she'll say, well, you know, I dated multiple people. And I go, ew. And I do it on purpose. She go, will you stop? I wasn't like you. And I go, that's right. Dating? I'm like, I ain't date. I wasn't trying to date. Yes, I'm in Delaware. Originally from New York. I've been here 7 years. Born and raised in New York. But yeah, emotional availability, very, very important, guys. You want to try to get with somebody who you can feel comfortable expressing your internal feelings with. Okay, got you. Shout out to you, Kirby. Love it. I'm down in Kent County, the low and slow part. I didn't want to be up north. I wanted it nice and slow. After leaving New York, I wanted all country. I'm out here with the flies and the corn and whatever animal might run by at night. When I first got here 7 years ago, I couldn't sleep. It was so quiet. I didn't know how to deal with the quiet. It was crazy. I was like, my wife was like, what's the matter? I was like, why is it so quiet? She's like, boy, shut up and go back to sleep. Yo, y'all better stop playing and put these hearts up. Don't make me ask you again. He says he's not going anywhere and made decisions to be... That's on him, but you still got to have those conversations. Annette, do you consider yourself exclusive with him? Because if you are, cool, have that conversation. But if you're not exclusive or you choose... Okay, got you. Yeah, I did the city thing. I hang out in Philly all the time. Years ago, I'm older now. I'm comfortable in my relaxation. I done partied enough over the years. Because if y'all are exclusive, cool, but never let somebody assume that y'all are exclusive. Have that conversation, because you don't want somebody hurt because you decided to date somebody else. And you have the right to date somebody else if y'all are not married. If y'all didn't agree to be exclusive, you date who you want. Well, okay, and I'm glad that you are always together, but it's still certain things have to be discussed, guys. You cannot assume anything when dating, because a person always have the trap door saying, I'm done with this. And you can do that in marriage too, but it's a little more difficult. But remember, y'all are dating. There's another step after dating, which is that marriage thing. But you want to be able to make sure that the boundaries are clear when you're dating. Certain conversations have to be had. And we have to understand that it's not just mutually exclusive, and mutually is the word, until you make sure it's mutual. There's a lot of people take ownership of another person's body once they have sex with them, and that's their own issue, but you got to make sure you're cool with that. I am dating three different guys. I'm not exclusive. Okay, cool. Enjoy yourself, Kirby. You're a grown woman. Or you're a grown person. I don't want to make any assumptions. I don't want to do that now. I don't want to offend anybody. But you're a grown person. And a grown person can have options that if they choose to. You're not exclusive with anybody until you choose to be. And I don't care what another person assumes about me. Until I say it's only you, I ain't trying to hear it. You definitely have to have that conversation when dating. See, because here's the problem. When you say dating, the other person may say, well, are you sleeping with all of them? Be honest, yes. Yeah, I'm an adult. If I choose to, yes. I like sleeping with multiple people. Be honest. If they can't deal with that honesty, then there's no reason to go forward. Because it's the truth. Never be scared to lay on the truth. You cannot play wife, no benefits, certain life situations. Yeah, of course. You can never play house, as my wife jokes all the time. Don't play house. Babies play house. Kids play house, not adults. My wife says that all the time. Adults shouldn't play house. Especially if illness comes. Let me tell you something. Do you know how messed up it is that you play house, something happens to your significant other, and all their resources, all their money, everything goes back to the person that they never divorced, or family members that may not like you because y'all were too scared to go out and make it official? And now you sitting there and you're not even listed on the funeral situation because you didn't actually do all the proper things. Don't put yourself in that situation. It hurts badly. And my wife and I have watched that. Where the side chick who thought she was the main chick finds out that he never divorced the wife, and the wife gets everything. I spoke to him about what marriage, and he made excuses and mostly checked out. Well, that's a conversation. If a person, again, we go back to the list. If a person, again, is not emotionally available, these are the conversations that you have to have, Chloe. And again, you guys have to have an idea of what it is that you need for yourself to be able to have those conversations with somebody. You have to know what works for you. So when you're talking and go, nope, that's a red flag for me. And again, what's a red flag for me is not going to be a red flag for you. But you got to be able to have those conversations. It's super important. Let me see. I'm losing my paperwork here. I watch on the joke. Okay, let me see something here. Yes, every day I work in a state plan. Yep. And I used to sell insurance years ago. And you know how many times that the insurance settlement would come in? And I'm sorry. It goes into probate court. And now all of a sudden the ex-wife or the family gets it. And here's the girlfriend or the long-term what's name. Can't do that. It's crazy when the ex-wife gets the benefit. Well, it's not crazy. It's legal. And you can't play house and then expect to get all the benefits of playing wife or husband, and you didn't actually put yourself in that position. It's super important. And we got to stop playing games with our relationships when the laws don't allow for the game. Stop the common law stuff. Most people don't recognize common law husbands, common law wives. Stop playing marriage. Get married and stop playing it, or get the money up and get the divorce. It took me a while to get divorced. I was out of the house in 2000. I got officially divorced in 2003. But it's important, especially when we're talking about a will, especially when we're talking about anything happening. We live in a time where anything could happen. Don't put yourself in a box where all of a sudden everything that this person would have given to you is gone. Domestic partner is not a spouse, and the laws protect against that. You want the credibility of the position? Put it on paper. Go ahead and say I do. And nobody has to know. Y'all don't have to let anybody know y'all married. You can go down and get the license and get married that same day. Nobody has to know y'all married. If that's what works for you. But don't play yourself. And like I said, I've seen it, and it's not a good look. All right, so y'all ready for the last one? And I'll go back over all 10 for you. And I love the interaction. But here's what I don't love. Y'all playing again. Y'all playing. What are we doing here? What's that one heart popped up? Thank you, whoever put that one heart. Y'all better go ahead. Thank you. I appreciate it. I try to be on point. I'm here for you guys. And to think, I was not going to come on. No, I was thinking about not coming on, but I can't. This is what I do. It wouldn't be fair. I love interacting with you guys. All right, so number 10, let's get 10 tens. Oh, y'all already ahead of me. I already saw Montana, I think, threw a 10 up there. Let's go, 1010. And if you want to see previous shows, they're over on my YouTube page. Just go to my bio. You'll see everything in my Linktree link. Actually, all of my information is in my bio. And actually, you know what? I'm going to read something from my poetry book since we're talking about dating and stuff like that. All right? But I'll do that when we're all said and done. You got a cute carpal tunnel. All right. Well, you know what? Hold the phone. Just stick your finger out and hold the phone. Stop playing. Or actually, get a stylus. Get a stylus and just tap it. We're good to go. Hey, Kevo. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Please let us know where you're checking in from. All right. So, number 10. Here we go. And for the brothers listening, we have intuition too, but please trust, women have a stronger intuition. I don't know why the creator created it that way. Number 10, trust your intuition. Trust your intuition. Number 10, on the list of 10 ways to identify a red, shout out to from Florida. Okay, cool. From Florida and Chi-Town. I haven't been to Florida in a few years. I need to go back. And Chi-Town I have not gotten to. I need to get to. That's on my list to get to. I got to go when it's warm, though. I ain't going when it's cold. All right, 10 ways to identify red flags when dating. Number 10, trust your intuition. It works every time. Really, Jose? It should work if we listen. The problem is, you know what, Jose? I'm going to agree with you. Josie, you're right. It does work. The problem is we don't listen. I'm going to rock with you on that, Josie. We don't listen to our intuition. It actually does work. Feel like I should have asked him to tell me he loves me. But how do I do that? You shouldn't have to ask, but say, to ask the question, how come you don't tell me you love me? And if he says, I want to hear it. Tell him what you want. When in doubt, be direct. When in doubt, be direct. Ask for what you want. A closed mouth does not get fed. Baby, you know I love you, right? Yes. I want to hear it from you. I enjoy when you tell me you love me. And when y'all sitting down cuddling, if you cuddle, say, baby, I need to hear you tell me you love me. I like that. I enjoy it. Come on now. Don't take that from me. And if that don't work, take him in the room and work him out and take that love from him. You're going to tell me you love me. But yes, when in doubt, be direct. You want to get some love from him, take him in there and get that love. You love me now, don't you? You say it. He says because he said that to get his way when he was younger. Okay, well, this is now. What you did it for then was for what you wanted now. So I now am supposed to be a victim of what your past is? No, you did what you did then, but saying it to me is not you getting what you want. It is to please me because I want it from you. Have that conversation. Unless there's some pain attached to it, well, then he might need to sit down with a counselor to discuss why it creates a negative situation for him. But yes, trust your intuition. Trusting your intuition can be a powerful tool for identifying red flags. Trust your inner voice. Now I want to ask the chat a very serious question. How many of you, just put me in the chat. If not, don't say nothing. Put me in the chat. If you had said to yourself something and you did not listen and it blew up in your face when dating. When you said to yourself, don't do that. Don't go there. Don't give them none. Don't give her none. Whatever. Put me in the chat. When that voice inside you told you what to do and you didn't listen. And again, I ask these questions to show how much we all have in common. There you go. You see? And I will raise my hand to that one. That is proof that many of us, not take that back, all of us have built inside of us radar that will signal to us when something's not right. The problem is we will override that radar for something else or for somebody else, and it gets us into trouble. You see how everybody said me? And y'all don't all hang out. Look at all those me's. Look at them, all those me's. A Benny, me. Sherry, me. A Curvy, me. And a Perfectly Josie, is that Jen, Annette, Mystic, Chloe, Foxy? See? And everybody, if I missed anybody, I apologize. When I was young and dumb, hey, listen, we were all young and dumb. But actually, not just young and dumb, we're all inexperienced to things that we have not experienced. So to a degree, we're all dumb to a degree until we learn it. Real stupidity is when you know it and you choose to ignore it and you do it anyway and it blow up in your face. Now that's true stupidity. See, being young is not a problem. Not knowing something is not a problem. It's once you learn it experience it, and then you run right back into it. Now that is dumb. And that's how I was as a dean. If you ended up back in my office for something I already told you, sit down and shut up. But Mr. B, I'd ask one very simple question. Did you know what I was going to do if you got in trouble for that? Yes. Why did you do it? And the kid already knew. So they couldn't answer. I said, okay, so how many days suspension you want? You already knew. So there was not a whole lot of conversation that was necessary. And when we're dating, same thing. You need to know what that looks like. And if you choose to go back down that road, you can't get mad at somebody. You can't get mad at them for doing you dirty if you place yourself in a position to be done dirty. That's what we're working on. Okay? All right. So there's your list of 10 for the day. I appreciate all of you, but I'm not leaving yet. So here's what we're going to do. I'm going to hang out. If you got some questions, I will gladly answer those questions. If there's any one of the list that you would like me to go over, please let me know. And again, I just want to thank all of you for being here. What is it, after 1:15? Okay. So I got a few minutes. I do have a couple of counseling sessions today. So I'm going to go change my clothes. But I also want to say this while I have everybody here, and I missed having Ellie here. To all the mothers here, I want to say happy Mother's Day to you coming up. Hold on a second. And so the idea is I want to wish all of you happy Mother's Day because, this is going to be tough for me. I don't have my moms. I don't have my grandmother, but it is what it is. I'm used to it. I don't get too emotional because I put that energy into my wife. And so I make sure that I celebrate her and I celebrate all the other mothers. So if you're without your mother and this is a difficult time of the year for you, I understand. And so what I want you to understand is that I know it's difficult. Being that you are a lifelong teacher, how do you learn from who teaches you? Life, other people, children teach me. There's always opportunities to learn in every situation that you're in and every person that you come in contact with. I learn from everybody. I learn from every situation. I learn from the students in my after school program. I learn from my sons. I learn from strangers on the street. Because the idea is that we have to be open to the idea that we don't know everything. And I don't know how to express to her without coming off. Okay, hold on. Let me back up a second. My partner has patience problems. She's frustrated. She yells instead of telling me what's wrong. Okay, so take a step back. And set the situation up first. What you want to do is you want to set the situation up where you go, can we talk? But not where she's feeling victimized or not where she's feeling pretentious. Sit back and say, can we talk? And then express to her how you feel and give her suggestions. But write it down first. Write it down before you get to that point so she's not feeling like you're attacking her. And then go ahead and have your conversations. All right. That's what you do is to be able to sit down and say, hey, listen, you know, I want to talk about this. I want to express this. And you go from there. Because, again, the opportunity is to be able to have that conversation. And like I said, I know this is going to be a difficult weekend for a lot of folks, but take some time out. Reflect on the positives that that person brought to your life. Reflect on the love that you had. And if there's anything that you didn't get a chance to say to it, say to them. Say to them, even though they're not here, speak it out into the universe anyway. I'm going to have a couple of minutes to say whatever to my mother and grandmother who's no longer here. But I'm going to spend that time with my wife and my daughter. Fridays, Curve. Every Friday, 11:30 to 1 o'clock, 1:30 depending on the conversation. Most of the time we go to about 1:30. Sometimes we even go a little longer. And if you want to see any previous shows, they're all over on Facebook. I record it and then send it over to Facebook if you want to watch any of the previous shows. But and again, guys, you know that next month, my new book, 12 Steps to Recovering from a Toxic Relationship, drops. It's probably going to be later on in the month of June. I'm finishing everything up. As well as I've written a bunch of other books. Wait a minute. I just said I was going to read you guys. All right. Hold on a second. All right. Let me see something here. All right. Let me read you something from my first book. Now, I read this last week. But Let me see what I'm going to read for, we got Mother's Day coming up, right? Let me read something for the ladies for Mother's Day. All right, you know what? I read one for, all right, because, you know, I got to get a book. Yeah, so everything's on my website. All right. I'm going to read this one. I'm going to ask this question. I asked this before, but I'm going to ask all of you this question. Put it in the chat. And some of y'all already know the answer, so if you know, don't ask. Put it in the chat if you believe perfection is a real thing. Put it in the chat. Yes, if you believe it is. No, if you don't believe perfection is a real thing. Do you believe that perfection is a real thing? Yes or no? Put it in the chat. Randy says no. Sherry says no. Benny says no. Kevo says no. We got a smiley face says no. Or a frowny face says no. Josie says no. Mystic says no. All right. I'm going to read this poem to you, and I'm going to prove to you that perfection exists. If you're ready, say I'm ready in the chat. I'm going to prove to you. If you're ready, say I'm ready in the chat. Ah, knowing that, you don't get the no trick question. Nope. 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 No. I'm going to show you that perfection exists. All right, here we go. I asked myself, this is from my book, A Man in Transition, published in 2008, 15 years ago. I asked myself, why am I so lucky? Is there a reason I'm so blessed? But you're never supposed to question God's work. I say God because how do you explain her patience with me? There is something about the way she understands my needs. Are there other women who would love another's children like her own? Would another woman be strong enough to trust God and take you back when you have tasted someone else's fruits? Her love is pure, pure enough to douse the evil that once filled my own. My vanity, pride, and smugness have been replaced with concern, endearment, and gratefulness. I am now concerned. I now concern myself with more than just my own needs. Her smile fills my heart with joy. Her tears burn at my soul and demand my immediate attention or screams for forgiveness. I am blessed with an equal. So again, I ask you, why am I so lucky? Does God see something in me I don't see? He must. She is sexy beyond belief, even when she sleeps. Can that comfortable look come from what I have brought to her life? The world is funny. One minute you're all alone, the next thing all your dreams are being answered. Thank you, God. Well, the only course of action is to leave all my worries and fears and concerns at the Lord's feet. Something about having the right woman makes each day and night and morning special. I really do have the perfect woman, if only in my mind. You see, perfection can exist if it's only in your mind, if you perceive it to be perfect for you. It may not be and may never be perfect for anybody else, but it can be perfection for you. And that is called Perfect Woman, If Only in My Mind by Keith K.L. Bovin. I wrote that in 2004 or 2005, something like that. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Now I'm going to give you, all right, see, because sometimes they forget that it's, they forget that us brothers. All right, so we got, I got a couple more minutes. All right, let me, this one is called That Smile. Thank you so much. I appreciate you guys. Y'all better keep tapping that screen. All right, here we go. I'm going to give you two more and then I'm gone. Because I'm going to leave you with one I gave to my mom. Thank you. I told you perfection exists. All right, here we go. This one is called That Smile. All you did was invite me in with that smile, and I wonder, can I hold up? The essence of your body and your soul captivate and sedate me. I am powerless from the notion of being in your thoughts. It has moved me to heights never reached in all my dreams. The feeling of your glance is like the warmth from sunlight of a summer morning. We have bonded, and you haven't even touched me. The tranquil serenity of your voice caressed my heart. My words get tangled when attempting to utter your name to others who will listen to my babbling. How did I become this lucky to have you and be accepted into your space? Who knew a monetary look could shake a person's soul and spirit? You are the reason I stand here wanting more of who you appear to be. Can I be the man that worships the artwork God has created? Am I truly worthy of sharing a being wonderful as you? Your beauty is a testament to a legacy that was yours long before you drew a single breath. Each intense thought firing in my brain sends word through my body that God is real. All you did was invite me in with that smile, and I wonder if I can hold up. No, she doesn't have to believe she's perfect first, Costin. Because in my mind, if I believe she is, it has nothing to do with her. See, your mind is the thing that controls you. It controls your move. So if you believe something to be true, then you can actually start to make it happen. This is the reason why we're supposed to. It says that whatever a man or woman can perceive, they can achieve, because you first have to believe that it's possible. So if I believe that a person is perfect for me, well, then there it is. Now, the person doesn't have to be that. Let me, and I'm going to leave you with this one. And again, because it's Mother's Day, I'm going to leave you with the one that I read last week. But I'm going to read it to you again. This is dedicated. This was a Mother's Day gift to my mother. Hey, thank you, Annette. I appreciate it. This was a Mother's Day gift that I wrote for my mom years ago. I wanted to give her something different for Mother's Day. I feel like just buying a card wasn't going to do it. And I had always bought her a ton of cards when I was younger. Not so. She can't believe she is perfect first unless she believes she is first. Well, again, what she believes has nothing to do with what I think, Costin. She's going to be whoever she is, or he. They're going to be whoever they are. What I think, what I feel, has nothing to do with her, because I can fall in love with somebody seeing them. I may not have talked to them yet. I don't know what that person may be, but I know what I think. I know what I feel. And if in my mind I feel a certain thing, now she can either confirm or he can confirm, but what I think and feel is on me. It's not on the other person. Again, perfection is in the person that holds it. They can confirm my idea of perfection. It starts inside your thoughts. But again, you're entitled to think opposite. I'm not going to go back and forth with you. I got you. We agree to disagree on that. But I believe, and that's what I believe. And you are entitled to think differently. All right, last one. Here we go. And this one is dedicated to all the moms. Hey, I wrote that. I love it. Thank you. Here we go. I love you, Queen. Here we go. This one is dedicated to my mom. This is dedicated to all the mothers that are here. So I'm going to end this with this one, and I just simply want to say to all the mothers, to all of you who have your mother, and if you don't have your mother, to the memory of your moms, grandmothers, and anybody else who had that motherly position. The essence of what I am started deep inside you when the Lord set me in place. Your choice to have me was the first of many that would lead my steps. Those late night talks and listening to you pray for me touched me inside you long before I could see you to return the favor. My suckling was our period of bonding. Who knew it was healing you? My cries were soothed with the beating of your heart along with the soft notes of song from your lips. The constant encouragement to venture on my own made me brave enough to step and fall, but I learned. Now it's outside and I'm a new fear begins, but you watch. But your teaching was clear as I make friends, smiling as I've been taught. You say, go ahead. I'll be here, and at the end of the day, my world is shaking, but I hear this is growth, and education shouldn't be feared is whispered in my ear. With each cap and gown and pictured day, I am becoming a man because of the woman you are. Hold on. My legs stretch and my arms lengthen. My face eases past yours, and now I look down at the center of my universe. My mind is confused and my body feels stranger. You have the answer. My manly eyes are opening. You point out class is internal and trash is external. So I understand what you meant when you said self-respect is not an option. Your face frowns as you look her look her over. You feel challenged, but she is not and will not be you. I am growing, and you got me here for a reason. Now I stand proud and humble that the Lord as the Lord smiles at the job you've done. I have blessed this world with heirs, and you are the roots of our tree. My feelings for you are still the same as that little boy who you didn't help when who fell and cried out for you. Now this man understands why you didn't run to pick him up. For doing so, I say to you, I love you, Queen. Happy Mother's Day to all of the mothers. Happy Mother's Day to all of the mothers who are no longer with us. Happy Mother's Day to all of you that believe that you are all alone. Whether you believe it or not, you are not. And to all the mothers whose sons may not have my words, but have my feelings, sometime we'll be able to show it to you. I had to learn to be able to communicate, but I don't get to this point if it wasn't for my mother and grandmother. My father and I reconnected when I was 39, but those first 39 years, it was my mother and grandmother who were able to help me stand up. And did I make mistakes? Yes. And that's actually in my book, A Man in Transition by KL. That's me on the back there. But if you go to my website, everything is there. If you go to my bio, the links to everything, my website, everything is there. You can always find all my information on my website. I don't hide anything. But I want to say to you guys, thank you as always. This show, as well as all the other shows, will be over on YouTube. And if you want to go to YouTube and check out all my other videos, I got about 400-something videos over there, by all means. And if you believe that private counseling is something that you need, I'm here for that. Thank you. I'm real about helping. There's a couple people in the chat now. I will not put their business out there. But I am the same person off of this app that I appear to be right here. And when you meet me, if you decide to have a counseling session with me, this is what I do. I bring to the table a wealth of experience as well as a couple of degrees there. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much. I appreciate you. And again, I don't put other people's business out there, but I'm glad you guys can confirm what I'm saying. I don't go live because I don't do drama and I don't jump all over the place. Here I am every Friday, 11:30. Again, I want to thank all of you. And I appreciate the hearts. Thank you. And again, if I can be of any help, reach out. Hit my inbox if you have a question. If you need a counseling session, just go to my the link in my bio, set up the counseling session. The first one is always free because I got to figure out if I'm the person that can help you or not, and then we'll take it from there. Don't let money be the reason why you don't reach out to have a conversation with me. All right? I'll always try to figure something out if I can. This is what I do. So again, happy Mother's Day weekend. And like I said, it's going to be a little difficult for me without my mother and grandmother. But I'm going to pour all that love into my wife and my daughter. I think I'm cooking king crab legs and some colossal shrimp. That'll help take the pain away. I'm just not sure what I'm going to make with it. I'm thinking some Spanish rice and some vegetables, I believe. I'm not sure if I'm going to put them on the grill, though. I might break out my grill for the first of the season, but I don't know. We'll see. But yeah, some Alaskan colossal king crab legs and some colossal shrimp, and I'll figure out. I like to cook too, so like I said, I don't spend a lot of money on myself, but I do love to cook, and I know how to cook. My mother and grandmother made sure that. My grandmother used to joke. She said, "We ain't gonna need you. You ain't gonna need no woman to show you how to cook." I was like, me too. I'm pouring that love into other food. There we go. What, when's dinner? That would be Sunday's dinner. I don't know what I'm making tonight or tomorrow. I actually didn't take anything out of the freezer, so I'm not really sure. But I know the crab legs and shrimp are supposed to be delivered today. So I ordered them from Alaskan King Crab. I've gone to the website a few times with them. So and the crab legs only take like 15, 20 minutes in the oven. Or if I put them on the grill, it takes about 10, 15 minutes. The colossal shrimp, I'll see. I'm not sure. I'll probably just bake them in the oven. I'm not sure. But I have a wealth of seasoning, so I'm not sure. So I'm thinking a mixture of Old Bay's and some Slap Your Mama. And a touch of some cayenne pepper for a little kick. But we'll see. I think I'm going to go with like a butter sauce today. We'll see. I might even ask the wife. She doesn't care. She's like, however you cook them, we good. And so I might make some seasoned butter for the Alaskan king crab legs. I like to cook at home because I don't like to, one, not get enough food when I go out. But I hate paying for stuff that I can make myself. So I just started downloading recipes, and I have a George Foreman, I have a slow cooker, I have a conventional oven on the top of the counter, I use the regular oven, I got two grills. So I pretty much can cook whatever I need to make, and I've made a little bit of everything. So oh yeah, without question, garlic goes without question. I use I use a little garlic powder. So it makes the butter a little bit thicker. Have some chives too and cilantro if I need it. But yeah, I have a little bit of everything seasoned. And actually, I get authentic seasonings from other countries. I have some Indian seasoning I get for some of the Mediterranean dishes that I make, as well as I have actual Jamaican jerk sauce that I get from Jamaican distributors. So I got a little bit of everything. I have almost two cabinets full of seasoning. My wife goes, if you don't stop buying seasonings, I'm like, that's how I make the food. She don't really complain. She likes it. But yes, garlic is definitely garlic and a touch of oil, some butter, and like I said, I use garlic powder, and the powder makes the butter a little bit thicker, and then I'll add some other seasonings to it. I made some pulled pork about a 2 weeks ago from a whole pork butt. Had to leave it in a slow cooker for about 11-12 hours and then pull it apart, chop it up, and a little bit of vinegar added toward the beginning. So guys, but I thank you so much. Let me get ready to go again. No one complain. My mother used to say that too. My mother said, as long as you can cook, ain't no woman gonna complain. And that was always something that I always, when I was out in the streets, and if you don't believe me, here we go. Actually, I tell my story here in this book right here from Gigolo to Jesus, and if you want to see my lovely wife here. And in my book from Gigolo to Jesus, I actually talk about, you know, what I was when I was out in these streets. This one here is actually a fictional story, but it's actually a fantastic story about a young man, a young educator torn between his love for women and doing what's the right thing, but his mother and grandmother keep trying to tell him that messing around with these women is going to get you in trouble, and you get to read the story and see what happens because he couldn't control himself. And, you know, as I say to you guys, I'm for real. I'm the real deal. But I am here if you need me. I want you guys to be safe. I will see you next Friday. All right? Talk to you soon. God bless, guys.